bhavatu sahana bhunaktu sahaviryam karavavahai tejasvinavadhitamastu ma vidvishavahai om shanti 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 om samasta jana kalyane niratam karunamayam namami chinmayam devam sadgurum brahma vidvaram So we were seeing about japa. Last session we saw about how mantra japa works. What is mantra japa? It is to repeat the name of the Lord. And what is a mantra? Mananat prayate iti mantraha. That which helps a person to go across the limitations of the mind by reflecting upon it. Now we saw the logic of how it works, how mantra is a potent spiritual sound formula. And mantras have different aspects. So there is a deity, there is chandas, there is a devata, there is shakti, there is kilakam. So there are different aspects of a mantra. So any sound cannot become a mantra. These are specific sound arrangements also. And they are chanted in particular intonations also if they are Vedic mantras. So there are different categories of mantras. Sattvic mantras are those which are helpful for peace, for quietude, for liberation, for inculcating good values. Rajasic mantras are those which are for progeny, for prosperity, for power, position, all that. And tamasic are those which are for even harming some people and to enjoy some powers over nature, etc. A lot of black magic, etc. will use all this. So when we choose a mantra, the mantras a spiritual seeker chooses are sattvic mantras. And so when we choose a mantra, ideally it is to get an initiation from a master, then that is the best. Because the mantra has to be activated. Nowadays they have no software has to get activated. You have to press a link, then only it will work like that. You have to activate it. Why is it so? Because without that, the disciple has to put their own effort and tremendous amount of work to open up the power of that mantra. The guru who has already done that, if initiation is taken from that person, then it will work the best. So it is said that once there was a conversation between a king and Vivekananda. And he was saying about this, that importance of a mantra and the initiation should be taken from a guru and then it will get activated. So the king didn't believe. So Vivekananda immediately he ordered. He called out to all the soldiers and he said, all the soldiers come here and arrest this king. He is very, very stubborn. He doesn't listen to what I am saying. Arrest him. None of the soldiers are moving from me. Again, Vivekananda said, I am telling you, arrest this king. He is a very arrogant king. Just put him behind bars. Nobody moved. Then it is said that the king got very angry. And the king told the soldiers, you arrest this monk. Immediately they came. And Vivekananda started laughing. So the king said, what happened? Why are you laughing? He said, see, the order I gave and the order you gave is the same, but my order had no power and your order has power because you have the authority, you are the king. In the same way, the mantra can be the same, a disciple can chant it or a guru can chant it, but the guru has that power of sadhana, has activated it. So if the guru gives that mantra, that's why there's in spiritual culture, there's a lot of importance to mantra diksha. To take from a particular person. So personal initiation, if it is taken from a realized master, then that is the best, because the person, the guru sees the person's level of evolution and gives a proper mantra according to that. If that is not possible, take initiation in mass. If that is also not possible, pray to Bhagavan to reveal the mantra to you, and then you start doing the japa. Mantras are also to be chosen based on where there is love. Who is my Ishta Devata? You know, and that mantra has to be chanted, because the mind must abide in that mantra. Only when there is love and there is bhakti, the mind will abide in that mantra. And once you take that mantra, just hold on to that name. Don't keep shifting. It is not the mantra that is doing anything to us. Through the mantra, it is the Lord whose beings are getting invoked. And Bhagwan is how many? Many or one? 100% sure. But we may say intellectually, but in the heart we always feel Bhagwan is many. You know, Shivji is not responding. I think I'll ask Ganeshji. Ganeshji is not responding. We may say intellectually one, but then we keep on shifting, go on doing this, this, this. And we tell people, you know, if you believe God is one, if it is your personal puja room, keep only the form of your Ishta Devata, remove everything else. Why take a chance? Suppose that God gets angry, then let them all be there. It's okay. Conviction is not there. One feels in and through whichever form I am reaching that one supreme only. And the idea of the whole sadhana, upasana is to get single pointed. If it's a common puja room, then each one may worship a different form, so let it be there. But if it's a personal puja altar, one. So choose a mantra of Ishta Devata and do japa only of one mantra, Ishta Mantra. Maximum we are allowed is Gayatri Mantra and Ishta Mantra. And in that also, Ishta Mantra is more than the Gayatri Mantra, the quantity. Only two, not more than that. Don't say that for health I want to do Mrityunjaya Mantra, for wealth I will do Mahalakshmi Mantra, and then for prosperity I will do Lakshmi Mantra. Not required. Same Ishta Mantra can give every single thing. Because blessing is coming from the Lord. So Gayatri Mantra can be done with the Ishta Mantra. Now mantras are Vedic and Puranic, two types. Literally, actually, it is Vedic mantra only, because mantras have intonations and these are revelations to the great rishis, Vedic mantras. They are not created by any human being. So all these, Om, Gayatri Mantra, Mrityunjaya Mantra, Om Namah Shivaya, Om Ganganapataye Namaha. Actually, Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya is a Puranic mantra. It should come down. That's a mistake there. So you will find this in the Vedic literature. So Rudram Chamakam will have Om Namah Shivaya, Mrityunjaya Mantra. Om is there to all over the Vedas. Ganganapataye Namaha you will find in Ganapati Atharvashirsha Upanishad. So like that, there are different mantras which are all revelations in the Vedas, and because they are Vedic mantras, if we chant them with proper intonations, it is also the science of sound. Like what we just chanted in the beginning of the class, Sahana Bhavatu is a Vedic mantra. So like that, whatever is a Vedic mantra, if I choose that, then I should know how to chant it also in proper meter. Puranic mantras, Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya, Shri Krishna Sharanam Mama, or just the word Ram, or Shri Ram Jai Ram Jai Jai Ram. All those are Puranic mantras. They are composed by Veda Vyasa Rishi. And they don't have intonations. One can chant in any tune. Today people are chanting even the Vedic mantras in so many tunes. See, because they are Sattvic mantras, they do not have a repercussion in that sense. But the required sound, vibration and the effect that it should create, that it will not create. So better it is to chant with the proper intonation. And that mantra must be inspiring to you. Mantra may be anything, like Om is the most powerful mantra. One important point to understand in mantra is the shorter the mantra is, more subtler it is to meditate on that. It requires much more purity of mind, much more ability to focus. Longer the mantra, more supports the mind has. So if we just say Om, 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 that is more difficult to do than Gayatri mantra or Mrityunjay mantra, because that is much more longer. So we should not go only by what is the most powerful. Does my mind engage in it or not? Is it inspiring to me or not? That is an important criteria. Now, how do we use a mala? In mantra japa, mala is a very important aspect, especially in the beginning. So if you have brought your mala, you can take it out. This third finger, the ring finger, is that on which we keep the mala. So the mala has this bead. This is called the meru. This meru is the symbol of the Lord. So even if I don't have a form in front of me, the meru itself is the symbol of Bhagavan. So before we start the japa, as though mentally we bow down, so we touch it to the eyes and to the heart, symbolizing I am prostrating to the Lord. Then keep the mala on the ring finger. And then close this with your thumb. So touch the tip of the ring finger with the thumb. Now this becomes a closed loop. So now the mala does not fall. Now, with the middle finger, turn the bead inwards, this way, after doing the chanting. Om Namah Shivaya, turn it inside. Om Namah Shivaya, turn it inside. Don't turn before. So the samskar of the mind is should be what? Chant and then turn. Om Namah Shivaya, turn. Why are we turning it inside? The symbolism is let the mind turn within. So to keep the integrity of the body, of the speech, of the mind, all the three, this mala is very helpful, because the hands have the mala, the heart is chanting the name of the Lord, the head is thinking of the meaning. And now I chant and then I rotate the bead. Om Namah Shivaya. Om Namah Shivaya, Om Namah Shivaya. This is one method to hold. If this you find it difficult, then on the middle finger you can keep and with the thumb rotate. This is another way. But bend all the three fingers so that the mala does not slip and fall. In both these methods, one is careful the mala doesn't fall. Because generally what happens, as the mind goes into drowsiness or one gets sleep and slowly gone. So one holds. Now hold it parallel to your chest, the hand, and generally one holds it close to the heart, and that's how one does. Generally one will avoid keeping it below the waist. So this way one doesn't keep the mala and doesn't touch it on the ground near the heart. Hand is parallel to the chest and one does it. Om Namah Shivaya, Om Namah Shivaya, Om Namah Shivaya, Om Namah Shivaya. Like that one goes. And you finish this, one will come to the last bead. When one comes to that last bead, then what should one do? One does not cross the meru. One turns the mala. So if you come to this last bead, turn the mala. And again start. So now the last bead becomes the first bead. Idea is that the mind will remain alert. And also the principle is that the Lord is the supreme. Nothing is greater than that. So one never crosses the meru like that. So that's how one uses the mala. In the beginning, when we use the mala, it is to keep a track of the quantity of japa. And also it is to keep us alert. Because when I have to turn the bead, my mind should be alert, as well as when I have to turn the mala at the end, again the mind should be alert. Mala also grasps the vibrations. Specific deities have specific malas to be used. Shivji's mantras, all of them we use generally Rudraksha mala. Vishnu mantras, we always use Tulsi mala. Devi mantra, we use Patik mala. So like that, there is specific material with which the mala is made, if one uses that. Otherwise, in general, there is wooden mala also available, sandalwood mala available. So many different types of malas are available, one can use. Now, mala is required only in the beginning. For a few days or a few months, mala is not to be used all the time, because our objective is not to remain at the body level. Our objective is to transcend the body level and even the mind. So mala is a disturbance otherwise. At the higher stages, the mala will become a disturbance. So one puts the mala aside, or as one becomes familiar, one doesn't use the mala, one just does. So, you know, there is a mala in your hand also. That is called karmala. What is the karmala? These two are the meru in the karmala. So, we don't use these two. And the japa starts from here. From the ring finger, the middle line. One, Om Namah Shivaya, 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 Om Namah Shivaya. 10. Again start from here. So from ring finger, the middle portion, then we go down, then come to the smallest finger, up, come horizontal, come to the index finger and end at the base of the index finger. So it is like this. So that's the way it functions. And so we use this 10 times. And you use here also 10 times. So that will become how much? 100. 100 become in the hand only. Then you do extra 8. 108 over. So some people ask, why? What is this 108? So there are different explanations given for that. Astrological significances are also there for that 108 number. Nine grahas, 12 houses. So 108. And very interesting, the distance between sun and the moon, distance between earth and the sun is 108 times the size of the earth. And distance between earth and the moon is 108 times the size of the moon. From spiritual standpoint, 8 is this world of plurality. Ashtamurti Bhrit, we say. This whole world is made up of 8 things. 5 elements, sun, moon and jiva. 0 is maya. 1 is Brahman. So from multiplicity or plurality, we move towards non-duality, crossing maya. So 108. If you have a smaller mala in the beginning, that helps. 27 bead mala, 11 bead mala, because then to maintain concentration, that will be helpful. Longer mala, we don't have to turn fast, so that mind also tends to become drowsy. So better we start with a smaller mala and then increase it to the bigger one. Maybe 27 you start with, then come to 54 and then come to 108. And there are bigger malas also after that. So that way, one uses a mala in the beginning to get the concentration. Now, 10 essential things to do japa. First is, if we are able to maintain the time, every day, same time, if I am able to do the japa, it will help the mind to quieten down much more easily. It's just like anything else. This is nothing meant specifically only for japa. We eat time to time, then what happens? At that particular time, the body also is tuned. When we play, every day if we play at the same time, So the mind gets tuned, the body also gets used to that. The place, wherever we are doing spiritual sadhana, it will tend to have the energy vibrations. Direction, one faces the north or one faces the east. Asana is an important aspect. One sits on an asana because the energy should be conserved in the body. It can be a mat as well as it is the erect posture and not shaking. A picture or a form must be there in front of us so that whenever the mind becomes disturbed, again I open the eyes, I see the form, close the eyes, again visualize and again continue the mantra. Then rhythmic breathing. Before I start doing the japa, I must have rhythmic breathing. So if I do any pranayam or even just simple deep breathing, that also is good. But the breath must be in a rhythm. One important thing is the breathing rhythm and the chanting rhythm need not match. And should not match actually. Because while I'm breathing, while I'm chanting, the speed of chanting can be different. So I don't have to try and match the breathing to that. Otherwise I will start panting when I do loud and fast chanting. Mala can be used. Now one important thing is one should keep one's mala only with oneself. It should not be public property or anybody wants, they can use that mala. Mala and asana should be individual. Mala can be washed. Don't think that if I wash it, the vibration will also get washed away. Nothing happens. Keep the mala clean. Chanting of the mantra metrically is important. If it is a Vedic mantra especially. Quantity also is an important factor. In Bhakti Sadhana, one says that if you maintain a particular quantity, every day I will do this much minimum, that is a commitment of the mind so that the mind doesn't waver. Otherwise the mind feels today I will do one mala, tomorrow I will do half a mala, after that even that half mala goes away. Or suddenly one feels inspired, I will do 10 malas today. And the next day one says very tiring, I won't do. Consistency is very, very important. So quantity and the number of times we do also affects our karma. So many times, some negative karmas which are there of the past, they are eliminated when we do a certain number of japa. So quantity makes a big difference. Even some of the astrologers will tell you, itne karod month, itna karod time jap karo. And if you cannot do, they will say, get somebody else to do it for you. Most impact it will have if you only do it. If we cannot do, then we tell somebody, then we make them do it. It has some impact, depends on so many factors there. How that person is also doing it. What shraddha is there, how much single-pointedness, how much it is dedicated to you, so many factors. So best is to do by oneself, and the quantity, if we say ki every day one mala, 108, or two malas, whatever number we fix, to stick to that quantity is a very important factor to get the steadiness of the mind. And the last is contemplate on the meaning of that mantra. So mantra will help us to not only attain concentration, but the contemplation on it will bring about the surrender as well as the purity of the mind. So what is the meaning of that mantra? One should contemplate on it after the japa is over. Now two other factors are, generally one says that one should sit near a water body, then the mantra japa will become more enhanced, and light a lamp. Both these also, if possible. If it is not, don't say, okay, water body is not there, so I'm not doing japa. Just continue to do japa, light a lamp and do. I know people who tell me that. It is said here in the scripture that there should be a water body. If you sit near the water body, then the mantra of japa will become heightened. So whenever I find a water body, wherever I go, then I sit there and do. Otherwise, I don't do japa. No need. You just continue. How do I repeat the mantra? with devotion and single-pointedness. We may start with soft and slow, make it loud and fast, again soft and slow, chant the mantra mentally, witness the chanting, and then silence. If the mind wanders, you bring it back to the form. If you feel sleepy, open the eyes, see the form. And if you feel that if you close the eyes, again the mind will feel sleepy, then do open-eyed japa. But don't give it up. If the mind feels sleepy and you say, no, I am not going to do today the mantra japa, I am feeling very drowsy, I think I should sleep for some time and then continue. One is physical exhaustion. If I have not slept at all properly, then obviously that is going to happen. But if I have done that, then it's a trick of the mind. One should not fall for that. So keep the eyes open and complete the quantity of japa. Don't get up without that. While doing the japa, what is the focus? Any of this can be the focus. The form of the Lord or the mantra word itself. Suppose we say Om, then the form of Om. Namah Shivaya, then Namah Shivaya. The words itself. Because the mantra is the sound representation of Bhagavan. It is called Vangmaya Avatar. It is not just some alphabets. The power of the Lord is hidden in that form, which is the mantra, as a alphabets also. So visualize the words of the mantra or concentrate on the sound. You may not have a form in the mind. Concentrate only on the sound. These are in increasing order of subtlety. Or concentrate on the silence between the two repetitions. Suppose you say, Om. Another silence. Om. So between the two chants, the silence which is there, I focus on that. And last is contemplate. So any of these can be done depending on how subtle and single-pointed my mind is. When do I repeat the mantra? Fixed quantity every day is a must. After that, whatever you do is extra. Some people, they don't do this fixed quantity. So they will say, while I'm walking, I'm doing japa. That is extra. That should not be a substitute. Before eating food, you can express gratitude to the Lord. You can take a mantra break instead of a coffee break. Mantra break, you take 2 minutes, sit quietly, chant the mantra, open the eyes again, start doing the work. When negative emotions overwhelm us, you can take a mantra walk, chant the mantra fast, walk briskly. So breathing, chanting and walking, synchronize. When we lose our equanimity or very elated and excited we are, any of those times one can chant. When one is scared, nervous. So mantra can be used at any time, even while doing so-called mundane tasks. One can chant the mantra. And it can also be dedicated to somebody. So if you dedicate it to somebody, when we visualize the Lord, before we start the mantra, we imagine their form and we tell Bhagavan that, oh Lord, this is dedicated to such and such person's well-being or for their prosperity or health or whatever it is. May it help them. And then with bhav, we do the whole thing. At the end, again, we visualize them and say, the Lord, please help them or bless them. So beginning and the end, two times one does it. So that's how the mantra japa is done. So this is step number. In the 10 steps, which step number is this? 7, concentration. So today we will do, again the same Om mantra we will do. So that is not a japa, no? That is Ashtotra Shatanamavali. So Namavali is a sadhana that we chant once. If you use that as a japa itself, then that is time consuming also, and that is so many mantras in that. 108 mantras are there. So generally in japa we will use only one mantra. Yeah, one has to do that only. No? The mantra that you have taken from a Sadguru, that is what is to be used in Japa. The one does not need to do any other mantra after that. Once you get it, then keep doing only that. Yeah, early morning Sattva Guna is more in the environment, so it has more impact. But it should be that I am fresh at that time. Then definitely better. You know what I'm saying? While I'm waiting somewhere, I'm doing the japa, the attention is still on the body and the things outside. If I sit down and do, the importance of that is I have withdrawn the senses and the chance is to go beyond body identification and go beyond the mind also. That doesn't happen while being awake. So that's why sitting down and doing exclusively is very, very important. No, you can wear. There is no problem. One can wear it on the neck as long as you keep it clean, that's all. One has to wash it regularly, that's all.